Blackstone Audio presents The Romantic Manifesto, A Philosophy of Literature, by Ayn Rand. Introduction. The dictionary definition of manifesto is a public declaration of intentions, opinions, objectives, or motives as one issued by a government, sovereign, or organization. The Random House Dictionary of the English Language, College Edition, 1968. I must state, therefore, that this manifesto is not issued in the name of an organization or a movement. I speak only for myself. There is no romantic movement today. If there is to be one in the art of the future, this book will have helped it to come into being. According to my philosophy, one must not express intentions, opinions, objectives, or motives without stating one's reasons for them, i.e., without identifying their basis in reality. Therefore, the actual manifesto, the declaration of my personal objectives or motives, is at the end of this book, after the presentation of the theoretical grounds that entitle me to these particular objectives and motives. The declaration is in Chapter 11, The Goal of My Writing, and partly in Chapter 10, Introduction to 93. Those who feel that art is outside the province of reason would be well advised to leave this book alone. It is not for them. Those who know that nothing is outside the province of reason will find in this book the base of a rational aesthetics. It is the absence of such a base that has made today's obscenely grotesque degradation of art possible. To quote from Chapter 6, the destruction of romanticism in aesthetics, like the destruction of individualism in ethics or of capitalism in politics, was made possible by philosophical default. In all three cases, the nature of the fundamental values involved had never been defined explicitly. The issues were fought in terms of non-essentials, and the values were destroyed by men who did not know what they were losing or why. In regard to Romanticism, I have often thought that I am a bridge from the unidentified past to the future. As a child, I saw a glimpse of the pre-World War I world, the last afterglow of the most radiant cultural atmosphere in human history, achieved not by Russian, but by Western culture. So powerful a fire does not die at once. Even under the Soviet regime in my college years, such works as Hugo's Ruy Blas and Schiller's Don Carlos were included in theatrical repertories, not as historical revivals, but as part of the contemporary aesthetic scene. Such was the level of the public's intellectual concerns and standards. If one has glimpsed that kind of art, and wider, the possibility of that kind of culture, one is unable to be satisfied with anything less. I must emphasize that I am not speaking of concretes, nor of politics, nor of journalistic trivia, but of that period's sense of life. Its art projected an overwhelming sense of intellectual freedom, of depth, i.e., concern with fundamental problems, of demanding standards, of inexhaustible originality, of unlimited possibilities, and above all, of profound respect for man. The existential atmosphere, which was then being destroyed by Europe's philosophical trends and political systems, still held a benevolence that would be incredible to the men of today, i.e., a smiling, confident goodwill of man to man and of man to life. It has been said and written by many commentators that the atmosphere of the Western world before World War I is incommunicable to those who have not lived in that period. I used to wonder how men could say it, know it, yet give it up, until I observed more closely the men of my own and the preceding generations. They had given it up, and along with it, they had given up everything that makes life worth living. Conviction, purpose, values, future. They were drained, embittered hulks whimpering occasionally about the hopelessness of life. Whatever spiritual treason they had committed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.